This conference will now be recorded.
चंद्रा आर यू एबल टू हियर माई वॉइस चंद्रा?
I guess he has left.
That was Chandan, I guess. This is Chandra. I think he wanted to show something, but I don't know why. He has not yet shared anything.
Okay, he has arrived. I'm just inserting on my screen.
Okay, so let's start, guys. So as we already discussed yesterday, we will be going through some few predefined measurements and how do we identify that what is the problem and which metric will help us to identify that problem. So this is our agenda for today. Let me just make the notes. So we will go through this specific, these are the basic counters, right? So these are all whatever we are looking out looking right now are the system counters, right? Network memory, your server queues, threads, processes, the processor, physical disk. This all is your server counters which belongs to your system, right? So we'll go through the each and every one that how what are the possible issues you may face in the network and what are the possible remedies are there and which counters will help you to identify those things, right? Then we will see some few other measurement criteria or some few other measurements. Then we'll go through the different types of log file formats that that are created for this system, right? And the main things will be to look for the J2EE monitoring, right? So J2EE environment, how do we monitor this environment? Okay, so just make a note of one thing, guys. So nowadays, though we have this very sophisticated tools like all the APMs are available, like you have Dynatrace, you have Dynamics, you have File Introscope. So these all the tools have made these things easy for us, right? But it is very important for us to understand the basics, right? So why before these tools were available, before this tool were existed, how the things were done? Because even the tools were not there, there were still the performance engineering was happening, right? So we need to understand how these things were done in the old school ways, in other words. Okay, so so today we will not be going to the PPT. Actually, I tried to make one small HTML file because the tables that I wanted to elaborate were getting too long for the PPT. So I had just downloaded my HTML file. I'll quickly open it. Okay. Okay. So are you all able to see my screen?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Sanan. Okay. So this is just listing the agenda, whatever that we have, discussed in whatever that we have presented on the slide. So these are the major objects we will be looking through: network, memory, queues, threads, and CPUs. Okay, so let's just start. Let's go through the network. Network first. So what in the network? Right, I will just explain you first the legends and all these things. So at the right side you can see. So the T I have mentioned it is for the Unix. Unix RStat D. These are the daemon counters which are collected from the Unix server and we are notified them as a T. right? W prefers for the Windows counter, S is for the Sidescope counters, and R is for the Linux or Solaris or SAR counter. I think hardly there is any R in the tables below, but you will see most T and this W. Okay. So let's say let's start now. So network Ethernet interface. So we all know that in our Windows machine or in our Windows computer, we have this network card, right? NIC we call it, network interface card. So this is a very important part of your machine when it is, you know, when it is subjected to connect to the outside network, right? So what may be the potential issues with network when we are dealing with the evaluating the application performance? Okay, so I have listed a few of the issues that I face that I feel that that are important to, you know, share over here. So first is collision, right? So I think everyone is familiar with what is collision, right? So it is just in other way we can say the traffic between the packets when traffics you know, when the packets collide with each other, there are the traffic is high. So this may be an issue. This is specifically detected on the Unix boxes, collision rate, right? So how do you measure it? So there are the packets per second counter on the Unix box. If you go through the network monitoring, so you have this packets per second in your Unix box, right? And then what is the threshold action? Okay, so let's, before we start, let's get familiar with the all the headings that we have in your our table. So at the leftmost side we have the object, so the system object that we will be you know, looking for looking the counter for. Then we have the potential issue, that what might be the issue with this object. So network interface, what might be the potential issues we can have. Then we have the summary counter, so which counter can summarize this you know, issue, then identify this issue, right? So what are the different counters that can help to identify this issue? Then we have the subset, if there are any subset of this counter, like main counter, then subset counter, like memory is a main counter, subsets are memory used, memory committed, memory maximum, right? Likewise, then we have the total, so this total counters, and then the threshold for action, and the last is potential remedy. So threshold for action will vary depending on the network. Okay, so right now, as you can see, this collision has given the threshold as greater than 1%. If at any point of time you have collision rate greater than 1%, it has to be an issue, right? So what is the potential remedies now? Now just observe one more thing, guys. So I have grouped all this, you know, potential issues with the potential remedies. So there is the right side, you can see there is one potential remedy I mentioned, this reduce the number of machines on subnet of the subnet of use, or use a higher bandwidth network, right? So it reduces the number of machines on subnet or use higher bandwidth network. This is the potential remedy for two potential issues. One, three issues. One is your collision, then second is your utilization rate, and third is your error rates. Okay, so we'll just I will just elaborate that how these things are aligned. So first is collision, that I think it's very clear and crisp, that how do we find out the collision rate of the packets in the Unix server monitoring. We see that packets per second counter, and if it is greater than 1%, right? So how do we calculate it? 1%, if there are total packets per second rate is 100%, 100 packets per second, and total packets received is 1000, so it is 1% of that 100 packets, right? 100 is 1% of that. So if it is greater than 1%, then you need to make sure that there is an issue. You need to check it, and you have to reduce the number of machines and on your subnet, on your network. So in order that the traffic will regulate, or else you have to have a higher bandwidth. Okay, let's see the second issue. Second issue says that utilization rate in bytes per second. Okay, so now what is utilization rate? So there is a network utilization rate. So when I'm saying that my all system are connected in the 1 gigabits, 1 Gbps of LAN, 1 Gbps network. So what is 1 Gbps network? It means that at any point of time, there is a maximum availability of traffic moving from one point to another point is 1 gigabits per second. So what is the maximum traffic utilization any server or any node on this network can do is that maximum capacity which is mentioned, right? So 1 gigabyte is can maximum can be utilized, right? So this can cause issue when this utilization rate increases, this causes again some issue in the network. So how do you identify it? So this current bandwidth counter is that, like right now I already explained, right? 1 gigabits is my bandwidth, so that is how you use it. But you know, most of the time we get confused with this bytes and bits, right? So theoretically it is bits per second, okay? Though it is you know, though you saw you see all the things and bytes per second, all this theoretically it is bits per second. So every 8 bits per byte, like that. And there is a subset for this particular counter. You see at the right side, bytes received per second and bytes sent per second, right? So these are the two counters you can take. How many bytes are sent per second or how many bytes are received per second, and depending on that there are the total counter is there, bytes total per second. So you have to, you know, just by overlooking you can judge very well if the total byte total per second is exceeding. You can see that there is a potential issue in the utilization. It is if it is very high, right? So you can identify what is specific bytes are high, the bytes which are being sent from the network or from the node is high, or the bytes which are received from the node is high. That's the second thing. Okay, so let's move to the third issue, which is again same in the space of utilization, but this is the error rate in packets, right? So you might have seen that when we do this ping, right? Everyone might have used this ping command in the Unix boxes, right? So pinging just to check if the other server is accessible or not, right? So in the ping command, if there are any at the end of the ping command, you have this summary, right? How many packets were sent, how many packets were received, how many packets were lost, right? Or errorless packets. So if you have this high error rates in packets, you will have a potential network issue, right? So the solution for all these three issues is either you reduce the number of machines on your network or you use a higher bandwidth, right? So how do you identify if the packets are there are errors in packets and it is causing the utilization to go down? So you can see that incoming packet rates per second in Unix, right? So T is for that Unix boxes. In Unix boxes you can see the counter from incoming packets per second, and then you have in Windows you have packets received per second, right? So below I mentioned few of the commands, that's sar, ipan, ycache. So but these commands does not work in nowadays Unix boxes. Okay, I mentioned to forget to, I have today one Unix box terminal now, just to show you in case if there are any commands, and we can also quickly revise the commands that we saw yesterday at the end of the session. Okay, and I will share you these commands after the sessions are completed. So this is the way that in under Unix box you have this counter name as incoming packets per second, and under the Windows you have packets received per second. So what is the total counter now? Your packets received plus packets non received. So there is one more thing, this unicast and unicast per second and non unicast per second. So unicast packets are the packets those which are completely edible. I mean, edible in the other words, we can say that can be directly consumed by the network. And the non-unicast packets need some kind of formatting from the network side. They need some, network interface. You might know about that, how this network works, right? So we have the network interface card, then we have NDIS, some network software is there to work, so network interface card just sends the data. So it just sends the data from, it just route the data from one point of the node on your network to the other point. And the NDIS software is at the back end. It will involve the everything. I mean, it will take care of everything. It will monitor these packets. It will identify where this packet has to go and what information this packet is having and all this thing, like decoding and all this thing, right? So this is the way you can see that, and Under the this in the same counter, outgoing packets rates per second is also measured, right? In the Unix, you have outgoing packets, so incoming packets and outgoing packets rates per second. So from this, you can actually when you see both of the counters, if the rates are very mismatching, you can identify that how many packets are errored out, right? So depending on that, you can come to the conclusion that this is the case: either reduce the number of machines or increase the bandwidth. Okay, then we have a specific counter related to error only, right? So you can see this error count: packet received errors, packet received discarded, packet received unknown. So these are the three different categories of under Windows machine or under Windows server you will see related to errors related to the packet, right? So under the received errors, you will see this either received, discarded or unknown, or output for the packets which are going out from your network, from your server, you will see packets outbound discarded, right? So this is the case. If this is the case, if these counters are very high, the threshold is actually shown greater than one. So in ideal condition, there should be no zero packet should be discarded, zero packet should be come as unknown, right? So if it is greater than one at any point of time, or it is greater than one for a consistent time, you need to adjust the network buffers, right? So this is the possible remedy for this. If this error count for packet received errors is greater than one, you have to adjust the network buffers. We will see in the below where we have discussed this network buffers. Okay, then there are interrupts. Okay, so nowadays these interrupts are not so much critical to use, because there are very much alternative software solutions are there for systems to interact with each other, apart from using the IRQs, the interrupt request. So there are no specific any kind of remedies available as of now, or because most of the guys or most of the developers prefer software ways of interrupting the processes or interrupt the ongoing processes. So it is a very more sophisticated web approach, and it also adds a very less overhead on your CPUs. Okay, then we have delay, network delay. Okay, so what is the threshold for network delay? It is I will just mention in the Windows. I didn't found any relevant names for Unix network delays, Unix server network delays. So under Windows, you have the output queue length. So what is output queue length? It is again related to the packets, the bytes that are being sent. So if that queue length is greater than 2, it has to be the buffers issue, network buffers issue. So how this network's NIC cards work is that from the NDIS, the software that sits on the top of your NIC card, it will process the data that has to be sent out from the server. This data will be then given to the NIC card, and then NIC card will publish this data on the network. But at any given point of time, the NIC card should function continuously. So that's why in between NDIS software and your NIC card, there is a network buffer, right? So whatever the data NDIS is processing, it is storing this data in the network buffer, and your NIC cards, network cards, are picking up that data from the network buffer, and it is publishing on the network, so to travel further with all the information like source, destination and all these things. If you have seen the network packet, you will identify. Okay, so *-y, so this is not available in SciScope. Okay, so now we have this a Unix terminal, so we can quickly see what it gives, right? So this will give you the basic CPU information and all those things that are listed on your Unix box. Now you can see this *-y. I've just listed the first. First it has given you the box name. What is that Linux box? It is I used an AWS for this. So I've created one AWS box, one Unix box in AWS. And just to show you this command, how this gives you the information. The left side is time. Yeah, it can be clearly seen. The TTY is nothing but the shell sessions, how many sessions are. Then you see that received in seconds, X emptying in seconds, frames in seconds, PR tire in seconds, BRK is in seconds, OR overruns in seconds. So this is all related to the processes. How the but this everything is zero now because there is nothing running on this server. It's completely blank. Just to show you the output of the commands, I've just got this server. Okay. So this way, sar-y, you have various options available with sar. You just give sar question mark, and you can see this different types of option are available. If you just do sar-a, capital A, it will give you the entire working, entire report of your system, right? So it just, let's see, just see. See, if I just given the sar-a, and it listed out everything, right? So it will, whatever the, sar is about system activity report. So whatever is going on your system, so everything it will report, starting from the CPU to memory. You can see this memory table is there. How much memory is freed, used, consumed, buffers, everything you will get. So this is a basic monitoring system. Why it is used in a that these tools, the nowadays we have these APMs and all these things, right? At the back end they use the same commands, right? So it is very useful for us to to be aware of it in case if you don't have any APM tool in your environment, or if the client is restricting to use any other third party tool, then how do you analyze the engineering, how do you do your engineering reports, how do you analyze the issues? So these are the basic root commands that are helpful to analyze it. Okay, so the next, that is the favorite command. I mean, most of the, this command works in both Unix as well as in Windows. So let me also show you that. Netstat. Okay. Now you just enter the netstat. It will give you the system. Then it will give you the numbers, and then the port status and connection established. And then it will give you the number at the right side and what process it is running up. For which process that port is open. There are different options available with netstat, like netstat-a. If you do, you will see this all the list. So this is the basic netstat. Even if the same thing can be done with the netstat. So if you just give the netstat, netstat-lnp. Okay. So it will give you those servers with everything, right? The ports which are listening, the number, the nodes. So guys, there you might observe some differences when you are running the same commands on the virtual boxes and the physical boxes, because a few of the things on the physical boxes they directly communicate with the network cards, and on the virtual boxes they have separate, again, a software version of your network's communication. So you might see some differences in the commands when you compare it with Unix and Unix boxes with physical and the virtual boxes. So now you can see that netstat-lnp gives you the local addresses, the foreign addresses, the state of the connection, which is it is listen, or in Windows you see it established, right? It is in Linux you say it's listening, and in Windows you see established. Let me just quickly show you the command prompt also. So now so you can see that its state shows established. In the Unix it is listening, right? So it is listing all the things now, whatever the connections from this my computer, my laptop, it is going. So it is listing. Now you can see this EC2, this is the Amazon web server, this is the host name of the server, EC2 user. Okay, so it is established. So it is, again, you get entire activity listed over here. So how this is helpful? You can identify what all the connections are open from your network, right? From your node to the other outside network, and you can list it out, all the things. Solaris, this doesn't work in Solaris. Okay, so picking a network monitor. So this is I've just explained whatever things we have discussed above, right? So how do we do that? So to determine if the number of network buffers need to be higher, what the buffer number of error-free packets the system is dropping, Okay, so how do you get the error free packets? It is just the summation of your or the subtraction from your total packets throughput and the sum of the packets outbound discarded, right? We already saw that the if the packets are packet discard count is high, then you have an issue with your network buffer, right? So the same likewise the counters, you know, the packet outbound errors and packet received errors, so they indicate the network card hardware problems. Same way as we already say that current bandwidth, so don't rely on that this counter because it's a theoretical, right? So when we see that 1 Gbps and one more thing you might find interesting, all the tools that we already have in nowadays, right, they don't have this kind of counters reporting current bandwidth, right? You will never see any specific counters related to current bandwidth in any nowadays tool, any APM tool. May it be a Dynatrace, may it be a your SiteScope, may it be your AppDynamics or anything, you will not never see this counter current bandwidth. There may be a description or there may be a network overview where they will say that network is connected through this bandwidth, 1 Gbps line, or this is the network bandwidth, but you will not see the counter that how much utilization is being done of this bandwidth. Okay, so why we need to do this network analysis so much, or why do we need to be very cashy about this network buffers and all these things, the network utilization, the bandwidth utilization? So the reason being this is that this network, whenever there are a lot of network traffic and the network packet rates are high and the bandwidth is highly utilized, so what happens is it actually adversely affects the CPU utilization, right? Because as I already mentioned, right, so this network cards are that they directly don't process your data. There is an NDI software, I think I mentioned somewhere. Yeah, so you can see over there, similarly the output queue length you should not use, it is always zero because network cards doesn't process anything. So the processing software is NDIS, right? So because this network NDIS software has to process the every data, every packet is that is being received on the server or that has to be sent out from the server, it creates an additional ad hoc on your CPU, right? Most of the time it left undetected, right? No, the network issue is the most it's most far thought issue in any case, in any performance case. So few of the performance engineers are like that, so they will start with network first. They will earlier days the network was a bigger problem. Nowadays the network bandwidth is easily available, so nowadays there is not any issue with network most of the time. So earlier days it has to be the performance engineer used to start with the network first, and because that is what is connecting the servers, that is what is connecting to the architecture, so he has to start with the network first. He will see that how the network is behaving, is everything is good in the network, is every server is able to get what he is expecting, or every server is able to send what he has to send, right? Okay, so this is just basics for you, that how do we get this out of the counters, how do we pick to identify any specific issues. So next we have this network monitor. So I will show you this. I think I haven't installed in my system. So under Windows you have this network monitor. So I don't have installed it. Let me just install it. Netmon for Windows 10. Okay, so this is the latest version 3.4 for Windows. So this will report the every activity, every network activity that is going on from your network, but and this will also additionally create some overhead on your CPU. We will see that in a few seconds. Okay, so just again guys, just to remind you, just note one thing, all these things are available with APM tools as of now, but it is for as a performance engineer we need to understand what is even the APM tool, what it is doing at the background, right? I quickly install this. Okay, so it is installing this network monitor parser. Okay, so there is a parser software also. So whatever the packets that we have received, you can give your own parsing rules. So you want high capacity, I mean, if you want to see the data as soon as you have received it, or you want to have an elaborated view of data, you will see there are 3-4 types of parsing available. Can directly launch that from command prompt. Okay, till this time, till time it gets downloaded. Let's. So there are some. So this is some the things I mentioned over here. So network monitor from control panel. So in earlier system it has to be there. Nowadays from Windows 7 on onwards we don't have that management. And monitoring tools available, of the option available, the Windows features we do install, right? So this option is not available in the management tool. So I also mentioned one, you know, here the whatever I was explaining, the activity drains the resources of computer you are analyzing, because the limit network segment monitoring network segment counters increases the CPU use. As this counters processes network traffic, they use additional system resources, because you know for computer also it needs to identify what packet is coming, so he needs the computer also needs to process it, right? So there is a significant processing power which involves doing that. Is it done completely or not? I think it is done. Okay, I think it is done, right? Let's see if we are able to. It's not to match file. Okay. So you can see that I've just opened this netmon on Windows. At the right side you see that all this what's new in this thing and everything, and we'll just start the capture. Okay, it will. Okay, so now you, as you can see, none of the network adapters are bound to the netmon driver. If you have installed, you may need to log out and log back in. So I don't have any network card, so whatever traffic is going out from my laptop, it will just monitor this traffic, but I don't have any network card, so that's why I'm not able to see anything. See, okay, so the settings seems not to be there somewhere in the network card. And this is the problem with the laptops. Okay, so you guys at least got an idea that you can do it, this kind of exercise at your on your desktop if you have. I am not sure whether it will work on your laptop. If you have an NIC card on your laptop, it will surely work, but I don't have it, so I am not able to see anything. Okay, so let's just move forward with this thing. Okay, so Chandan has some interesting question over here. Let me just. Okay, since NetMod take more CPU space, what is the alternative option or tool which uses less CPU? Okay, a very good question, Chandan. So yeah, just quickly minimize it. Okay, since NetMod takes a very high CPU usage, so I'll just elaborate the question Chandan has asked to other audience. So Chandan is asking that you know, we have seen that if the network bandwidth utilization is high, it adversely affects your CPU utilization, right? So if we want to monitor the network entirely, if you want to monitor everything that is going out of the network, coming into the network, what are the packages and other, so it will additionally create an overhead of your CPU. So what is the alternative method? You know, because I don't want to I don't want my server to invest the CPU processing power on just monitoring. I want the server to concentrate on what it is built for, you know, the application specific functionality and everything. So how we can, you know, minimize this CPU consumption? So there are something like network snippers at the right side, you can see. So there are some network sniffer tools are there. You know, you might have heard about Wireshark, WinPCAP. These tools are the network sniffing tools. They will give you the same information that NetMod will give you, right? But at the very higher level, you can nowadays they are very powerful tools. They will also try to capture everything that your network card is sending out and the network card is receiving, right? So it's like a gateway for your network card. So they will listen everything that is being sent to your network card, and they will try to analyze it outside the server. So what you can do is you can have a network sniffer at some another box which is, you know, specifically for monitoring, or which doesn't have any specific CPU uses, and it is free for use for monitoring. So you can install your network sniffing tools over there. You can configure the host that has to be monitored for network, right? So this is an alternate approach that you can follow for the network monitoring, because NetMod is creating a lot of CPU overhead. I hope that was I hope your answer was satisfied. Okay, now the favorite topic of all, so memory. So it's the next object. So what is the what may have been the potential issues when we are dealing with the memory object of the system? Okay, so RAM installed. So you know what is the amount of RAM installed? Then you have how do we find out in the RAM if RAM utilization nowadays? It's very simple. In Task Manager also you can see the performance tab. What is the RAM you have using? Can see 4.8 GB in use, available is 3 GB committed, and you have different types of options available right now. I mean nowadays, so available kilobytes or MBytes, and if it is less than 300 MBytes, add memory. This is a straightforward issue. RAM is being used, and how the counters that you can see this available kilobytes or MBytes in the Windows, and committed bytes for paging. So if you are using a virtual memory now, just quickly go through there. You can see that paged pool 348 MB, non-paged pool 460 MB. So this is the use of a virtual memory, right? You may also know that we have a paging file in every system, right? So this is how that paging file counter is also used. If that is also occupied, or if that is also full, you need to add some more memory. This is a basic issue for RAM. Now memory leakage. Again, pool paged bytes, you know, if it is an increasing this counter in Windows, a pool paged byte, if it increases over period, right? So that surely means you're leaking the memory, right? How do you come to that conclusion when it's leaking the memory? Because the pooling or whatever, say that paging or pooling is only done when your immediate system resources are not available, right? So that means if your RAM is not available for your operation, for the server operation to perform or store its objects, whatever getting created or whatever, the operation it is performing, that will be pooled, right? So the things that are already in the RAM that will be pooled. So you If you see this counter increasing over a very long period of time, it is pool page bytes is increasing, increasing, and increasing only, and it reaches the capacity. That is an issue with your memory. It's a memory leakage. So I've potential remedies is given Java, like use Java, because Java has this garbage collection facility and memory management is there already, right? Then we have this page fault, right? For this is also the same case. So page fault operations involved in physical hard disk activity rather than just the soft memory, right? Because if there are a lot of page faults, this one counter, I feel very surprised. This is very very this counter is ignored by a lot of testing guys, tester guys, or a lot of members, because even if even when I ask this kind of questions that why, what is the significance of page faults, no one knows about, or very few guys knows about this. What is page fault and what is page fault recovery operations are there. So this is very important operations when you're very stringent on memory, right? That means if your memory is not easily available for your systems or your applications to work on, you have this, all these mechanisms are there, like paging files is there, paging file is created. So if a paging file is created, this counter has to be there. You need to measure this counter, how many page faults are there, page faults are happening. So if there are a lot of page faults, that means your hard memory, the physical memory, right, disk memory, not the RAM, because paging file is created outside RAM, right? So your disk memory will suffer. Okay, so what is the threshold for this? This is greater than 20. If your page faults are greater than 20, you need to look at your hard disk, the memory, right? And again, potential remedies, as I just given as Java, because I didn't find any specific potential remedy for it. But one would be that you have to have your paging file at the nearest location for the system to access from RAM. I mean, how does Windows system access its memory? It accesses it in a sequential manner. So it has the immediate access available for RAM. Then inside the ROM, it will go to the partitions. It will go to C drive first. Whatever the drive comes first, it will access that first. So the basic idea to improve this kind of scenario is have your page file always in the C directory or the root directory, whatever directory which is nearer to RAM or which is easily available for access. Okay. Then we have pages involved in page fault physical hard disk activity rather than just the soft memory that we already seen. So for this, that is the threshold is greater than 5 and increase the paging file size. That is an alternative option. And also remember that when you're increasing the paging file, you need to make sure that the disk space is available in that directory in which you are creating the paging file. Right. So is there any enough swap pings? Okay. So swapping is another phenomenon that is used in Unix most probably. In Windows, we have paging. The same way in Unix, we have swapping. So what is swapping? So the like in Windows, when there are no there are the critical operations that are being used, and they are using the RAM, and now they are idle. Those idle users that will be paged or that will be pooled. The same way swapping happens in the Unix boxes. So what happens in the Unix server is that if let's say if your particular application is processing something, it is invoking some of the commands, some services are running. Now the services are at the idle state, right? The application needs those services for the further operations, but now the services are in idle state. So what Unix server will do, it will pick up all the service data, all the everything that service has been processing, and it will swap it. When it will do it, when it is running out of RAM. Okay, understand it. When swapping occurs, when your RAM utilization is approximately more than 80%, right? So at that time, what server will do, what kernel will do, Unix kernel, it will move that area of the RAM, it will move that activity or move that operation to the swap memory. Okay, and whenever it is required, or whenever the Unix box, or whenever the application running on the Unix box demands that I need that service to be running now, so that again, the swap memory will again come in picture and it will again get moved to the RAM, right? So this is a very common phenomenon, and you need to make sure that there is a swapping facility available, and you have considerable swapping memory space. Okay, now that's discussed, that's done. Now how swapping affects adversely, right? So even if there is you cannot say like that ki let's say I have 12 GB of RAM on my Unix server, and I can see I can allocate 8 GB or I can allocate 4 GB of swapping memory. So at any point of time, if 4 GB space is utilized on my RAM's the Unix server, I can use that swapping for memory swapping. So my entire capacity will be 12 plus 4, 16 GB. No, it doesn't work like that. If there is swapping memory space is more, if the swapping memory area is more, the operations will get slowed down. You know, because server has to access to the swapping memory for a particular segment to get replaced again into the RAM so that it comes into the operation. So swapping, having a high swapping memory will not result, you know, will not be an additional benefit. I think Chandan has some question. Where will I see if application is having swapping issue? Okay, so I can show you. Okay, so this is the where we have just executed the sar command. Sar command will also give you some data about the memory utilization, or else you can okay, or else you can use just the top command. The top command will give you the swapping details as well. So you can see this KIB swap. So there is zero now. Okay, so available memory is 787060. So this is the swapping configured now for swapping, right? And the memory that is being used now, this is the configured memory, and everything that is free, that is used, that is cached, right? So here you can see swapping. How you can identify if the swapping is an issue? The counters, you have the swapping memory counters are there in Unix boxes. Number of bytes swapped, right? So these most of the times performance testers will ignore it, but as a performance engineer, you also need to check what is the swapping or what is the rate of swapping. How many times your server is swapping the memory, right? From the physical to again RAM or RAM to physical. If that count is high, that's an issue, right? You either increase your swapping memory space, or you check what is the potential reason that is which is causing this high swapping. Okay. Okay. So there is one more thing like this. The resident set size. So this is specifically talking about the processor. The process is running on the application or server or Windows server or Unix server. So how much memory is each process really using, right? So processes, depending on the application or depending on the functionality, the processes defines different working spaces, right? So the process can utilize their private memory or the only RAM. So I can just quickly show you few of the processes. Okay, so for example, okay, now you can see this task manager. So this is also a process, right? So it is running this process, and this it is using memory which is entirely RAM, right? So it is not using anything, any disk, right? But you can see this, there are some processes which are using disk memory as well, right? This is okay, now I will be able to see it. Now this process, service host delivery optimization, so this process is using memory, it is using RAM as well as it is disk, right? So some few of the processes are there which only use RAM. Now you can see this 562 MB. Most of the part of process is RAM. Disk space users is 0.1 MB only. You can see, what is this? This is Google Chrome. So it runs in your RAM. It doesn't need the physical space, physical access, right? Why this 0.1 is there? Because I've used this HTML file from my disk, hard disk, right? That's why this process is using the hard disk memory. So in Unix box, you can use this sar command again for to get this list, that how what is the free memory, the swapping memory. Okay, let's just quickly see it. Okay, so I hope you can see the screen, right? So you add the list KB memory free, it's in kilobytes, so memory free used, percentage of memory used, buffers, cached, commit, percentage commit, active, inactive, and dirty. Okay, so in this way you can see this details, memory utilization over the time. So left side you can see this this is a particular duration, some specific timestamp, right? So there is some kind of tool or some kind of utility which is available to identify if the, you know, the process is sharing some private bytes or not, or how many private bytes that process is sharing. So earlier days it has to be an issue with processes architecture. I mean, the processes were defined like the application's activity which will be using the hard disk space as well as the RAM. Right, but nowadays it is very much clear that process, what process has to do, and how it has to use the space. So nowadays you don't see that being a issue most of the time, but it's just good to have a knowledge about it. So you can also see this sar command. If you are monitoring on Unix server, now you need to know this sar command very good. I mean, you have to be very good at this sar command, because it will help you for everything. SAR is system activity report, so which will give you most of the things that other commands will not give you, or most of the things that other commands also give you that will also be included in SAR. So you just you can do man SAR, or you can do SAR slash question mark for the possible operations. So I given, it's very slow. I will say AWS is slow. Okay, so you can see, yes. Okay, so Chandan has some more question again. Can we capture SAR from NegiOS, because reading SAR will be time consuming for, yes, why not? So as I already told you, right, all these commands that I'm showing you, this is the old school method. The tools that nowadays we are using, the tools that are available, they are already using these commands only at the back end, right? So Chandan, so you may not see directly the sar command on the NegiOS, but you will see the counters that are coming from the sar command. So you need to understand what type of monitoring this sar command gives you, right? What kind of data sar commands gives you. So in NegiOS you will see everything related to that. I mean, you will directly see the counters, you will not see the sar command, but at back end, NegiOS is already doing the same thing. It is giving this command. But one more thing, Chandan, so in NegiOS, most of the time that it will not be the sar, it will be the rstackd. No, because NegiOS will be configured on some other server, and you will be interested in monitoring some other server, right? So in that case, that will be the rstackd. So rstackd and sar are most of the time similar. RStackD just gives you the data, gives you the counter that are directly driven from the kernel, right? And the SAR is specifically for the local host monitoring. I mean, if you are on the server, on the box, and you want to monitor the same things, you will get all these things from the SAR. Or there are some few of the problems or a few of the applications which can actually execute the SAR command on the box remotely and collect the data. Collect the data remotely. So RStackD has also been evolved, and this kind of data can also be collected from these commands in the Nagios or in any other application performance management tool you are using. Okay, so I've just used this man page for SAR. So you have everything, you have a lot of information right there. Just go through it, read it, what all kind of information you can get to the SAR. You can see the CPU utilization report, you can see the memory utilization report, so different types of memories. You can see the processor wise utilization, right? So there are very there are very very much possibilities for having a lot of data from SAR command. Yeah, you can see this note. The SAR command only reports on local activities, so whatever is going on this server, on this local server, it will report. Just because the SARs, the abbreviation SAR is the abbreviation from system activity report, so whatever is going on this local system, it will report. So there are a lot of options available. You can see this, the total number of kilobytes the system paged in form, PPG out per second, paging out, the total kilobytes the system paged out to the disk, faults, that then you can see this, the number of major faults, page repages, then pages scan directly per second, pages swapped, this is swap, scan by the kswap daemon. So you know, this is the information, so you need to be aware of this, right? Though we have the tools nowadays, but you need to be aware of this, how these tools are working. No, because no one is bothered about thinking that if I don't have this tool tomorrow, what I'll do. No, because we are so much dependent on these tools, we are least bothered about if these tools are not there, how we will do it, right? So this is the old school way, this is the methods how you do it. These are the same just flags I've got from the man command, and I've just pasted over here. So you can go through it on your Unix box. I will not invest much time to you explain all these things. Just quickly. Now server. Okay, so for server, because server is a very generic terminology, so I didn't know what should be present for server metrics. So I've just listed out few of the servers that nowadays we use specifically, like IIS server, then which is a worldwide web service, like then cache server, we have FTP service, then internet IIS global server, SNMP server, active server, then ASP.NET servers. Okay, so there are some few things I've listed out in server, so three lists only. So pool non-page failures, pool page failures, and pool non-page. So this is very generic, right? So on most of the Windows server, you will you can see this kind of specifics, because if we say a specific server, that the entire monitoring will be different from the server specific. But these are the three things which will be common to all servers, right? So pool non-page failures is what it shows you, the number of times allocation from non-paged pool failed, right? So what does it indicates? It indicates that your physical memory is too small, right? So understand the concept. So how this counter gives, this is how you read the counter and you analyze and you map it with the bottleneck. You see that non-page pool non-page failures are high. So what does it mean? It means that the physical memory is small, right? So this is the metric, this is the counter you are monitoring. You are saying that this is high. What does it mean? This is the bottleneck that you have mapped it. Physical memory is too small, right? So this way you need to think, this way you need to work. So understand the counter first. When you're reading the counter, try to map it or try to correlate it with the actual bottleneck or what might cause an issue, right? So draw a line between these two things. Then you have the pool page failures. What does it indicate? It indicates either the physical memory or paging file is near capacity. That means it's getting pulled if your pool page failures are increasing, right? What is non-page and page failures? I don't think that I need to explain it now again, but I'll just quickly summarize. What is non-page failures? The failures, I mean, actually, how can I re-summarize it? Okay, so let's say for a particular process or particular service, it needs some data to be paged. Okay. Now application or the server is preparing this particular process to get paged. Okay, to get paged means to move from the actual RAM memory to the physical memory, but it is not happening. It got failed before paging only, right? So you will call it as a non-paged failure. What is full paged failure? Now you already have the physical, you already have it paged. Some of the information of your system or service or process, it is already paged, but now it has to move back to the actual RAM, the RAM memory, but it got failed. Why it got failed? Because it was not able to move you from the physical memory to the RAM file, because the size is small. Physical memory or paging file is the near capacity. That means it is approaching its capacity. Even for moving the paging from the pages from one space to another space, I mean one memory to another memory, it takes some another space, some high space. You know, if you are a computer engineering student, if you have studied this computer engineering, how this paging happens. So before every paging event, there is a address, a memory address that has to be physical memory address and a virtual memory address that has to be defined. So where this page has to move from the physical memory to the virtual memory or the actual RAM, then you have to mention the, or if this has to be first evaluated, the memory address, then that page will move. So if this paging, let's say that paging, the page size is 2 MB or 4 MB, and you don't have that much space available in the RAM, it will fail. Okay, say, and this is another counter, full non-paged peak. So it will just show the, at any given point of time, what is the maximum using of your paging file, right? So it indicates that how much physical memory is your computer should have, or what you should need the maximum memory. Okay guys, so I think please, yeah, Chandra, application is using. Okay, so I think I have one question from Chandra. So do we have any counter if application is using only RAM, right? So that we already discussed right now in the previous section, processes, private bytes and all these things. Like this is right. There is a counter. I mean, you need to set it up, right? RCM memory packages, right? It will give you the clear idea if that Google Chrome is using only system memory or it is also using disk. Yeah, but this is very old. This RMC memory package, now that is this is very old, and this is only for the Linux servers. On Windows Server, I don't think on Windows Server you can already get this information in Task Manager. You can clearly see that this memory is your RAM, this is your disk. You can clearly see that. So I've just. What I will advise you, Chandra, if you have an access to any .NET application, you just check the .NET processes, because .NET application processes use both RAM as well as some system disk space, you know, because they have to run the processes and run the application pools from the systems. So they use the both system disk space as well as the RAM, so you will have a better idea. So it is clear, right? In Windows you can see the Task Manager, and Linux we saw this command sar -b sar -h -r, right? Okay, so just quickly go to the system thread queues. Okay, so this is another very important counter. It is related to the system again. So what can be a potential issue for your system thread queues? Understand it as a saturation condition. So what is saturation condition? How do you identify from the counters? So there is one counter, processor queue length. Okay, so let me just see if I can show you this processor queue length in the POC1. It's not listed over here. It is not listed over here. Current queue we have, but we don't have processor. Aging file also we have. No, I don't think that there is a counter available in the POC1, but it is a very important counter to, you know, monitor processor queue length.
I added it from side scope on the servers I was running. Okay, no issues, Shannon. You can again always refer to the recorded session. Okay, so processor queue length is how do we map it? So in, you know, do you remember the in the yesterday's last yesterday's session we understand about load average, right? In Unix systems, you the reported load average. So what was the load average? It was the number of processes, the percentage of processes that are waiting to get access from a busy CPU, right? In the same lines, what is processor queue length? There are some non-running threads on all CPU which are ready, okay, but they are not running, right? So the Windows processor queue length is it's part of Windows system object only, because it's only a single queue for processor time, okay? So even if we have the multiple processors, okay, let's see in the system counter then. Even if you have the multiple processor, you will not see different processor lengths for different processors. You will have only a single counter for your processor queue length. My name is Chetan. Yeah, we got it here. Let's just add it. Okay. Now we can see. Yeah, so there are, this is lot of, you can see this processor queue length. This is zero, right? So
always remember one thing: any queue in any applications or any queue ideal value should be zero or close to zero, right? So there should not be anything queued, you know. So this is the processor queue layer counter that we were discussing about. So it is very important. If it is going beyond zero, like if it's one or two, it's a concern, right? So you need to check what is wrong with this CPU, right? Unless the processor is running at very high sustained utilization, this counter is likely to return the result of zero, because it displays only the last observed value, not an average. So it runs on the last value. It is not consistently showing you the average counter. It is 1, 2. There is no average, no max mean, right? Like that. Okay. So the threshold, as I already mentioned, if it is greater than 2, if the queue length is greater than 2, you have an option. I mean, you have a problem. That means there are more threads indicating that processor is, it's a bottleneck in your processor. You need a higher CPU. You need more powerful CPU. Right. Next, under the same system threads, you have occupation. So this is again this specific is for your Windows only. So how much your system threads are occupied, right? So SAR-Q will give you the queue length of occupation. Let's see if we have that available in your perf mod. No, I think it's not. It's not there. So if, again, the same scenario, threshold action, if it's 90% occupied, more of the threads, you have the ADU. The potential remedies increase your CPU power. Then context switches. Okay, so this is again a very interesting counter. So what is context switches per second? So how do I explain it? Okay, so when there are two threads, right, two threads working of a same application, two threads are working and they are sharing some resources, right? So let's say there is an update query I have written for a database, and there is another insert query on the same database, right? So the same table that I am updating, there is an insert query which is again doing the same thing, updating the table. So what will happen is let's assume these are two threads. So update is another thread and insert is another thread. So these threads will need access of this table, right? So let's assume that table is your context, right? So these threads will need access of this your table. So once one thread is done with the table users, it will switch to the another thread. So that is what we call as a context switches, right? So if this is greater than 5% of total threads, that means you have less application per CPU, right? So the number of CPU cores you have available on your system, the allocation of approximately for the number of applications are running on your system is less. The combination says that you are using the less applications per CPU. You should use the less applications per CPU. I mean, if there are more applications assigned to one per CPU core, you will see this issue, you know, because they will thrive for the resources and there will be switching will happen. So the context switching will increase. Okay, so next system thread potential issue is the latency. Latency may, you can see that PR stat is there, given there. PR stat command can give you the time waiting for CPU, or MP stat can give you the context switches. MP stat, last time I checked, it didn't work on the Unix box. Let me just quickly see if it can work. So you can see that it is giving you the all percentage CPU time. This is user, this is nice, system, IO wait, this is interrupt time, software time, steal, guest, key, nice, idle. And So CSW is not working. Okay. Okay, so next is processor. So processor, we already know that the most common thing about the most common metrics about processor is the utilization and how the CPU utilization is, if it is increases, what would be the counters that we will be clicking. So percentage processor time or percentage privilege time in Windows, and what would be the potential remedy is scale up your CPUs, increase your CPU. If you have greater than 80% of CPU uses, just increase it. Okay. What is the utilization amount again in processor? Working set peaks, so working set per byte. This is measured in bytes. So if there is any difference between the working set bytes, the potential remedies is still unknown. Okay, then weight IO is always presented zero on Solaris 10. So some stats from the different types of OS. Then come to the processes actual running on the server. So that I think that we already discussed what is swapping, what is switching. So if the swapping is more, the process, the count of LWP transfer per second is more, or it is the threshold action is, if it is greater than one, you need more memory to swap. That means you need to increase the swapping memory, right? Same case switching. So if the switching is more, you need to have a more swapping memory, because a process swap outs per second is increased. You have to have some swapping memory assigned for your processes to work efficiently. So below, these are some commands I have listed specific for Solaris, and we have this SAR command for Unix boxes. So what I can do is, I think we are almost done now. So once the session is over, I will just mail you guys all these commands, you know, so you can practice on your own. Now physical disk. So again, sorry. So most of the time, you may not see any issue with the disk, because nowadays we have a very huge disk spaces available with this cloud era. But it is always helpful to identify what could be the possible or potential issue, what could be the potential bottleneck. So the queue length, we already saw that the same way it goes for processor queue length, the same way it is for the disk queue length. So the threshold action should be greater than, if it is greater than two, you need more hard drives, right? And what are the counter subset? You have average disk read queue length, average disk write queue length, right? Then the percentage utilization, if the disk percentage utilization is higher than 90%, then you need more hard drives, same. Then you have this utilization per incident. Like disk bytes per, so what do you mean by per incident? That means a specific intervals, like the spikes, the way we can correlate it with the spikes that we come in our performance disk, right? Some few point of the time when your user load is high, you can see the spikes in response time. The same way, some few processes demand the very high disk space uses at a particular time, and it is you call it as a utilization per incident. So that is an incident when a specific processes are demanding high disk uses or high disk transfer. So what is the threshold? Is less than 20 kbps. Okay, so it may indicate an app is accessing too little at a time. If the disk utilization is less than 20k, it is the application is accessing is too little at a time. Then you have your incident rate. It is again same ratio of writes keeping up with reads. Then the latency, it is again similar lines, the way we discuss it for processor, the same way it is for processes as well. So how do you measure it? So disk seconds per transfer, average disk second read, average disk second write. So all these counters, guys, you can add in the pop mod. Okay, now I have given some of the commands also for Unix boxes, so sar -d and all these things. will give you the same information that what we have in your Windows box. Okay, so disk I/O speeds are about 10 to 100 times slower than the memory, because you know, disk I/O speeds will be very fast when data is stored on filler disk arrays, because such devices usually have a large amount of memory to cache data. So it again depends what type of disk you are using. So there are right now in market you have IBM storage available, and there is some other type of storage I don't remember now. So a single spindle can generally handle 15 accesses per second. This is just an information that I will provide. So what is hard disk monitoring? How do we do it in Solaris? It's using VMstat utility. So you will get everything from the VMstat, right? The V8 column shows for database IO, what is the waiting? Let's try the VMstat. We have that portal open. So VMstat is this very popular command. So most of the monitoring tools also use this command to get information, and they represent us in a graphical format. So this is just a single instance of VMstat. We can run it with frequency, like 5 samples per 5 seconds. So it will just give you the every 5 seconds it will update it. Yeah, you can see. So because there is nothing running on this server, you can see this this is almost most of the counters will be zero. Okay, same way in Windows hard disk monitoring, you have different counters available. So disk perf is a utility that can be used for monitoring the performance of Windows hard disk, but most of the time it is not required, because the servers are more specifically, you know, configured nowadays to use the RAM space. So most of the time you will not need to monitor the hard disk drives of your servers, but it's just for information purpose I've included that. And DHCP audit alerts, again this is not required for specifically for the engineering part, but you can always have an information about how your DHCP server is behaving and how many what are the server properties, what is the server logging out. So you have the DHCP server also, DHCP location utility available in Windows, which will give you a lot of information. So coming to the other measurements, you have memory pool size, thread pool size, then temporary space. So this is a generic terminologies I've used. So memory pool size is nothing but that you the memory that has been reserved for pooling, right? So the same way that we use the page pooling, same way it is the memory pooling. So memory which is reserved for pooling, that is your memory pool size. And what is the metric? The handles, number of handles. So you can very much relate it with when you are monitoring the database servers. So the what are the number of handles are created for every process or every queries that has been executed, the memory pool size depends upon that. So in Oracle database you have two different sections like SGA, PGA and pool buffer bytes and all these things. So we will discuss all those things when we will be discussing AWR and all. Okay, so thread pool is again very generic term. So threads which are available for serving the incoming traffic. So how do you identify this? The context switches per seconds, right? So we already discussed about how context switches happens and how one thread will wait for another thread to acquire the resources. So that that metric is context switches. Then the temporary space is there. So what is temporary space doing is it is giving you some additional breathing space for your RAM or your memory. And what is the metric that can monitor this? This is page faults per second. If your page faults per second is high, that means you are running short on your temporary space. So there are some specific log file formats that are that are created by your programs, the commands that you are using on the Windows server. So this can be your system events that can be used by trace logs. So we will not go in detail with it because this is a very old, what we can say, this is very old way of analyzing these things and the old way of that things, those files are generated and how do you analyze it. But nowadays you already have this so very sophisticated tools like Splunk. Splunk can, you just fed any type of any format of file to the Splunk and Splunk will give a very good and graphical representation of all the data you have in your log file. Okay, so next is your this log codes again. It is for 8-bit Windows only, right? So 0 is success, 1 for error, 2 for warning, 4 information, 8 for audit success, and 16 is for audit failure. Okay, so this is some important thing that I wanted to discuss. Latencies, I think I already discussed it in the yesterday session, right? So what is the amount of latency? So how the latency client server and we discussed the client at latency, server latency, database latency. So what is the latency? How and how do you calculate it? So when it is just the amount of latency is the sum of this a time multiplied with n time, right? So what is a time? A time is nothing but the time of the time where it is within the application. The request is within the application, and end time is the time that is spent on the network, right? So when your packet is traveling from client to the web server to the app server to the database server and then coming back to the client as the response, this total time is your the latency. This is the this is how you create this A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, and A6, and plus N1, N3, N4, N5, N6, and N7. This is total will be your latency. Now this is again J2EE monitoring. So why I've included that topic is because most of people are not aware of J2EE monitoring, and because again the reason is we already have these tools which makes our life so much easy, and we don't know how to do that. So I've just included few of the steps. Believe me that you will not need to follow these steps at any point of time in upcoming days, but just for informative purpose that how do you actually do the J2EE monitoring. So earlier earlier days it was very resource consumption. Resource consumptive J2EE monitoring. So that's why that's I used word costly, right? From least costly to the most costly. The cost here specifies the resource cost, right? So monitoring a J2EE environment takes a lot of resources. So I've just listed out few of the things that how do you start monitoring a J2EE environment. So first step is just to find an end-to-end response time for a single user. And just find out the entire footprint, how much CPU it is using, how much memory it is using, how much network bandwidth it uses. So entire resource, resource footprint, and depending on that, you will decide which metrics to monitor, right? And once it is done, then you proceed further with the developers, to identify the specific things that to monitor on your J2EE environment. Because again, monitoring all these things. Causes a lot of CPU consumption from your server, from which you are monitoring this environment. Okay, so I will give you these steps also into today's email, so now you can have at least some idea about it. So that's all. ARM instrumentation is again old way of application response management. This is an API that earlier it has been used. This is also used by some of the HP tools. Like this is the enterprise business service management tool. So this uses ARM API. Nowadays it is now more advanced version of this ARM API. So that can use actually application response measurement. Okay, so I will not go into details very much details on it. Log analyze this again specific to this. Okay. Now, tuning application. This topic I think I did not include it in the agenda, but the priority of the process determines order in which process is scheduled for processing relative to other processes. So this is the just basic introduction about how do you tune applications. So process code, the priority of the processes is set by the process code, not by the operating system. The OS sets and changes the dynamic priorities of threads in the process within the range of base. So okay, so this is just a simple information. Okay, at last I have three questions depend on this session. So you can see that I'll also mail you guys these questions. So whatever we have from these two sessions, whatever we have discussed, I've just listed out these three questions on that. What is the usual what usually has the greatest negative effect on your processor performance? Which command you could you use to measure CPU load on a Unix or Linux system? Where should the Linux and Windows swap partition be located to provide the best performance? Okay, we have discussed these things. Okay, so I think I'm done for this session, guys. Please let me know if you have any specific questions or any issues. Any specific points you want to revise and all these things? Okay, so I think I take the challenge as no. So we are good to conclude this session today, and I will share you the details of the commands and all these things by email, so you guys can practice at home on your Unix box. Thank you for joining. One more thing guys, I just okay, I already left, so I will update you on the WhatsApp.